Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us this afternoon. My name is Jay DiLorenzo, and I'm the president of the Preservation League of New York State. We are thrilled to be hosting acclaimed historian Gretchen Sorin to discuss her book, Driving While Black, African-American Travel and the Road to Civil Rights. First, I'd like to thank our sponsors for tonight's event, the Peggy N. and Roger G. Gary Charitable Trust. If you're unfamiliar with the Preservation League, we are New York's statewide, not-for-profit historic preservation organization. And we work every day to promote preservation as a tool to revitalize our communities, protect our heritage, create local housing and jobs, and save the places that are important to all of us. We're particularly interested in telling the stories of New Yorkers whose contributions to our state are too often forgotten. This webinar is part of our Preservation Book Club, a monthly series that is sometimes a traditional book club and discussion group, and sometimes an author talk, like the one we're having this evening. And we have really been looking forward to welcoming Dr. Sorin to discuss this incredible book. First, a little bit about Gretchen. Gretchen is director and distinguished service professor at the Cooperstown Graduate Program, a training program for museum curators, educators, and directors at SUNY Oneonta. She is also a fellow of the New York Academy of Historians. She has more than 30 years of experience in the museum profession, working with more than 250 museums as a museum exhibition curator, as well as an education, programming, and interpretive planning and strategic planning consultant. Dr. Sorin writes and lectures frequently on museum practice, diversity and inclusion, and African-American history. Her books include Touring Historic Harlem, Four Walks in Northern Manhattan with architectural historian Andrew Dolkart, Through the Eyes of Others, African-Americans and Identity in American Art, and others. Today, she will be discussing Driving While Black, African-American Travel, and the Road to Civil Rights. This evening's event will offer you the opportunity to ask questions. Just use the Q&A button on the bottom of your screen and type in your question. And when we reach that point of the evening, I'll read them to Gretchen and she can respond. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Gretchen. Gretchen, thanks so much for being with us.
Jay, thank you so much. I'm really glad to be here. Let me start by sharing my screen and hoping that our technology right works. How's that? Can you all see?
That looks great.
Perfect. Well, I like to start about with this talk with a little bit of music. So here goes.
Oh, you know that every child, running for Jesus, like an automobile. Every child of God, running for Jesus, like an automobile. Every child of God, running for Jesus, like an automobile.
And that is the Dixie Chicks. The Dixie Hummingbirds. What am I saying? That's the Dixie Hummingbirds. And what I like about that piece is that they're comparing their Christian faith to the automobile. And it suggests how important the automobile was in travel for African Americans. So one of the most important things I think about the research that I've done is really thinking about mobility and how important mobility is to each of us. And of course, I don't think you can compare segregation and the mobility problems that are experienced by African Americans to the COVID crisis. But one of the things that I've noticed is that it's given people a little bit of a taste of what mobility denied means. So if you think about it, African Americans were denied the right to travel, to go where they wanted to go, when they wanted to go, from the time they first stepped ashore on the shores, in this case, in New Amsterdam, which became New York. And this is one of those, one of the famous illustrations that's on the bottom of a map of New Amsterdam. And so because mobility was denied, it's also important to realize and to think about the fact that mobility begins with forced mobility. So Africans are brought to these shores. And you might say, well, what has this got to do with the automobile several centuries later? And I think it's very important to think about how mobility continues in the, even in the 21st century to be denied to African Americans. When African Americans first arrived on these shores, you had to have a pass to travel. And this is an example of what a paper pass looked like. This particular one is a pass for a man named Benjamin McDaniel, and it was issued at Mount Pelier by Mrs. James Madison in 1843. It's also important, I think, to think about the fact that the earliest police departments in this country were established as slave catchers. They started out as the men and sometimes even the women of the community getting together every night with their lanterns and patrolling the community. Their purpose was to find enslaved people who might be off of their plantations and not where they were supposed to be, over their farms. But also they were there to intimidate, to make people frightened so that they wouldn't run away. Because if you did, you would be beaten and taken and put into jail and returned to your master. Just to give you an idea, these are what the badges looked like that were used by the slave patrols, very much like the modern day badges that we use with our police departments. So mobility denied also meant that African Americans took their mobility, they ran away. And that was part of the journey from slavery to freedom, was stealing yourself from slavery. And of course, if you were thinking about the next step on that journey from slavery to freedom, it would be the Great Migration. And the Great Migration was the largest movement within our country of people, largest migration. We know about Jennifer Lamack's work on the Rapp Road community in Albany. The Great Migration brought people from the rural South to the urban North, in search of jobs, in search of an escape from segregation and from intimidation and low-paying agricultural work, picking cotton. This is a family in Cranberry, New Jersey, on their way north. And many people took their automobiles and used them, tied every belonging that they had to those cars, and sometimes were able to escape in the middle of the night. Train stations and bus stations were often patrolled because Southerners, white Southerners, farm owners, plantation owners were afraid that their labor source would leave. So they kept a close watch on train stations and on bus stations. And of course, if you think about what public transportation was like, why is the automobile so important to African Americans? Well, public transportation was segregated. You had to sit in the back of the bus. You had to sit in the filthy Negro train car that was rarely cleaned. The bathrooms were rarely cleaned. They were humiliating. African-Americans didn't want to subject themselves, nor did they want to subject their children to these Jim Crow accommodations. And even in some areas north of the Mason-Dixon line, you found the segregation of public transportation. So of course, if you got in your own automobile, you had a private space that was yours, that was not where you didn't face intimidation, where you didn't face humiliation. Of course, there were so many things that were segregated: bus stations, train stations, phone booths were segregated, restaurants were segregated, libraries were segregated. There were so many different places where African Americans were told in the public sphere again and again and again that they were inferior, that they were not wanted, that they had to stay apart from other people. And that's why the automobile becomes such a really important tool to defeat both humiliation and segregation. And ultimately, and I'll talk about that in a minute, it becomes a weapon in the fight for civil rights. So African-Americans in their automobiles. By the 1950s, when the interstate highways are being built, African-Americans are beginning to acquire disposable income. And with that disposable income, they are buying automobiles just as they are consumers of percolators and television sets and other consumer goods. And they want to use their automobiles to travel. They want to take their children to see the country. They want to go to museums. They want to go to parks. They want to go to Niagara Falls. And they choose very large cars. And there's a stereotype of African-Americans that African-Americans chose these big cars and Cadillacs because they wanted to show off. Well, African-Americans chose these big cars because they might have to sleep in the car. If you couldn't find a motel or hotel, you might have to sleep in your car. If you couldn't find a restaurant, you had to carry your food. So everybody carried a big cooler full of food in the car when they traveled. They carried blankets and pillows. They carried extra gasoline cans because they may not be able to stop at a gas station. They may not find a gas station willing to sell them gas. They might carry gallons of water because if your radiator overflowed, you didn't know if you'd be able to find a place to get water for your car, your radiator. And so African-Americans had all of this stuff they had to carry in their cars. Now you can imagine with all that stuff, you had to have a big trunk. To sleep in the car, you needed a roomy, comfortable car. And I love this. The Buick was actually the most popular car for African-American families. It was large, it was heavy, it was hard to turn over. It would be, if you encountered a white mob, it would be hard to turn over a big, heavy Buick. And they were luxurious. And I love this ad because it says, this is for the Buick Electra, and it says, all the Electra lacked is a fireplace. It was really like your rolling living room. And of course, a Cadillac was a luxurious car too. And these cars were seen as very reliable. And you wanted a reliable car. You wanted a car that wouldn't strand you someplace on the road in a neighborhood that would be unsafe. And this is a wonderful photograph of this gorgeous Cadillac on a street in Harlem with a couple, both wearing raccoon coats. This is one of my favorite photographs. And of course, this is the famous Chuck Berry with his Cadillacs. He had several Cadillacs. Now his Cadillac is in the collection of the National African American Museum in Washington, D.C. But you can see how happy he is, how proud he was of his Cadillac and how well he kept it all polished. Look at those fins. So let's talk for a minute about the intersection of race and space. And it's really about race and the landscape of the United States. As African-Americans crisscrossed the country in their automobiles, they found that they were entering white spaces that they had never entered before. If you think about it, before the automobile, people didn't travel very far from their home communities. And just thinking about upstate New York, once my husband asked me, why is it that every little town has its own Presbyterian church, its own Methodist church, its own Episcopal church, its own little general store? Well, it was because people didn't go 10 miles to go to the Price Chopper or 20 miles to go to the drugstore. They stayed right within their little community and everything they needed was right there on their little main street in their little town, in their little village. People didn't travel very far from home. And so with the automobile, people are beginning to move very large distances, much larger distances. And it's starting to open up the country in ways that it hadn't been opened up before. But still, people are having to carry everything with them. They're having to carry their picnic basket, their beverages. They're having to stop by the side of the road if they're African-American. That makes the automobile very different for Black drivers than for white drivers who could stop, who could go to that restaurant, who could find a motel and stay for the night. It's also, as you're thinking about automobiles, important to think about redlining. Now, redlining means that those areas that were literally outlined in red were areas that banks would not give mortgages, and realtors would not give mortgages. And actually, the federal government was in cahoots with the realtors and the banks in preventing many African-American communities from getting mortgages, many people in the African-American community from getting mortgages. That meant if you had disposable income and you couldn't get a mortgage, you put that money, that disposable income, into a better car because you couldn't get a mortgage. So the automobile became the largest and most expensive purchase that many African-Americans made because they couldn't purchase a house. And there were all kinds of things and all kinds of places that were segregated. And I think this is important for us, those of us who work in the preservation field, to think about the places that were segregated that are no longer extant and that we have failed to preserve because they're kind of an ugly part of our history. This is a quite wonderful photograph of a segregated bus station. But there were nightclubs like the Cotton Club in Harlem, which it's in Harlem, so we think of it as a mixed race place. Well, people who were on the stage in Harlem were Black, but all of the customers were white. The Cotton Club was segregated. And this is just a program from Cab Calloway and the Cotton Club Orchestra. This is an interesting bit of architecture for Ed's Drive-In. And you, it's obviously a modern photograph, but if you look all the way to the right, you'll see a little window, a back window. And that window, which is surrounded by white paint, aside from the brick, that would have been the Negro window. So if you were going to Ed's Drive-In and you were African-American during the period of segregation, you would have to go around back and get your food. Think about how humiliating that was to be told to go around to the back. You couldn't get your food from the front. But there are still vestiges of segregation. You just have to go out and find them and look for them in the architecture. I don't want to let the North off the hook, because the North was perhaps not as segregated as the South, but we think of the North as not having any signs, not having those signs of segregation. And this is the Hotel Clark. It's in New York State. Obviously the best service for colored only. So there were signs in New York State and in other Northern states that indicated clearly that there was segregation. So this was a Negro hotel. As people went out on the road, there were all kinds of road signs and all kinds of indications of segregation. This was actually a fast food chain that was all over the West Coast. This particular one started in Salt Lake City. They say nationally famous for their Coon chicken, but it was all up and down California and in other Western states. And it was very common to see one of these if you were driving along the road. I think about the way that African-American children processed all of this racist material. And you perhaps are familiar with the study that was done, I think in the late 50s, where they gave a Black child a white doll and a Black doll. And they asked the child questions about those two dolls. You know, which one is the prettiest? Which one is stupid? Which one is, do you like? And of course the child always chose the white doll because they had been so treated. they understood how African-Americans were treated and they had internalized all of that information. Similarly, signs like this one could be found in a variety of states. This is a kind of welcome to Klan country sign, that this one in Alabama, capital city Claverns welcomes you. And if you went to Greenville, Texas, this was the sign that was across the main street. Greenville, welcome. The blackest land, the whitest people. Well, I wonder who is welcome in Greenville, Texas. This was also painted on the side of the water tower. So as you were driving into town, you were sure to see it. And of course, many, many hundreds of small towns in the United States were sundown towns. And they actually had signs like this. And a sundown town was a place that you were allowed to be during the day. You could work in a sundown town as a maid or a butler, a gardener, or any other kind of service, but you had to be out of the town by sundown. There was even a town in the United States in the Midwest that had a siren that went off at 6 o'clock to let all the black people know they better get out of town. And these are towns, there were hundreds of them all over the United States, from Darien, Connecticut to Sheboygan, Wisconsin, that African-Americans had to worry about. So you can imagine what it was like to travel. When you were traveling, to see these signs that indicated that you could face not just humiliation, but real danger, real violence if you invaded these towns. So in 1936, a man named Victor Green, who was a New York City businessman, published a small book called The Negro Motorist Green Book. Now, the Negro Motorist Green Book was not the first Black travel guide, nor was it the last Black travel guide. It was simply the travel guide that lasted the longest and that managed to have a Hollywood film made about it. It was published from 1936 to 1966 by Victor and Alma Green, and nobody talks about Alma, but I'm going to talk about Alma because Victor Green in the late 1950s, something happens to him. I think he either has a heart attack or a stroke, and he steps back from the management of the Green Book, and Alma takes over. And when Alma takes over, there are four other women that work with her as writers and publishers. And these five women publish the Negro Motorist Green Book until it ends in the 1960s. And I will tell you, this was really rare in the 1960s for a woman to be responsible for a publishing company. So you go, Alma. And this is one of the covers. This is the 1948 cover of the Negro Motorist Green Book. And I like it because there's a lot of information to unpack here. You know, have this perfectly dressed African-American couple, very light skinned, with the, you see their a little bit of their car, you see their suburban neighborhood in the background, you see their matched luggage. You know, the ideal couple. These are the people that Victor Green is courting with his Negro Motorist Green Book, the people that want to travel all over the United States and all over the world. The people that he wanted the Green Book guide to appeal to white people as well, because Standard Oil helped to fund the Negro Motorist Green Book. So the language in it is very middle class. It's very temperate. It's very polite. So he says things like, carry your green book with you, you may need it. He never says that this is all about segregation and these places are places where you're welcome if you are African-American. He never outright discusses segregation until the very, very end of the Green Book's run in the 1960s. And so he keeps it just very polite, very middle class. And of course, there are all these other travel guides. This particular one also courting the middle class. You can see up in the upper corner, the black couple who are playing golf. And I particularly wanted to talk to you a little bit about places like Rock Rest. This is a wreck of a building that was discovered by Clayton and Hazel Sinclair. It's in Kittery, Maine. And this is what it looked like before they started to restore it. It was called Rock Rest. The Sinclairs met in Portsmouth and they decided that they wanted to own their own business. And they started a tourist home, and African Americans went there by word of mouth every year for weeks, a week at a time. And it was a place where you could go and just get away from the racism, get away from the stress, and just be quiet and enjoy the Maine, the rocky shore of Maine. And this is what Rock Rest looks like. Now, ordinarily, you wouldn't say this is National Register material. The, you know, Rock Rest, it's a, looks like a New England cottage that they've obviously altered to make it larger. They've added this dormer on it. But these are the kinds of places that are so important in Black travel history and in African American history. And it's a dilemma for those of us who do preservation, because the Secretary of the Interior standards are not met in this building. And those standards make it very difficult to preserve places like Rock Rest. I had the opportunity to go into Rock Rest before the plaster actually fell, and take some photographs. And this place was 100% intact. It was as if they had just stepped out of the door. And you can see everything was still in the house that she had used. She used to do these elegant, Hazel used to do these elegant lunches. And here you can see these women gathering with their hats. I love their hats, for these very elegant luncheons that she would do in Kittery. And we had such a well-documented place that's so important. It also has a manuscript collection that's at the University of New Hampshire now. And people did not, in the early days of travel in the United States, people wrote letters to inquire about accommodations. And this is a letter to Mrs. Sinclair asking her if she's got space for at least 2 weeks in August of 1952. So if you think about how important it was for African Americans to plan their travel, you had to plan because you didn't know where you couldn't just stop at a motel. You had to have a reservation. You had to know where you were going, and you had to know that there was somebody there that would welcome you. And so people wrote letters to find out if they could get accommodations at hotels. This is before the telephone was so popular in use. Another interior from Rock Rest, Hazel used to make these incredible lobster dishes on Sundays. And these are her very gaudy lobster plates. But there are also other places around the country that should or should have been preserved, like Idlewild, which was an African-American resort in Michigan. And this is a photograph from the Idlewild clubhouse. There are motels like this one. This is Mackenzie's Court in Hot Springs, Arkansas, the South's finest Negro court. You see motels like this all along Route 20. But this particular one happened to be a segregated motel. And then there were large scale hotels like the Hotel Dunbar, which is in Los Angeles, and the Teresa Hotel, which is in Manhattan. And it's on the edge of Harlem. And this hotel is actually still standing. It's no longer a hotel, but it is, it's a beautiful, beautiful building. And this is the hotel that Castro stayed in when he came to the United States, because he wanted to embarrass the United States and he wanted to point out the racism of the United States. So instead of staying at one of the downtown hotels, he stayed at the Hotel Teresa in Harlem. And of course, there were places like Dookie Chase. And if you ever get to New Orleans, Dookie Chase is a restaurant that is still intact. It's still there. They have absolutely amazing food. And this is President Obama ate at Dookie Chase's. This is Leah Chase, who is the wife of the founder. She just died this past summer. She was in her 90s. And she was admonishing President Obama for putting hot sauce in her gumbo before he tasted it. And there it is. The gumbo. There are many places that were restaurants, and these places provided food for African Americans, but what's also important to think about is that they provided funding for the civil rights movement. Some did it quietly, some did it in a very open way. I think these are some ads, Green Book, and I think it's interesting that people put their pictures in their ads. I think they wanted people to see that they were Africans, that this was a place you could go and be comfortable and be welcome. So the automobile and civil rights is, the automobile becomes a tool in the civil rights movement. This is a march in Birmingham. And after this march, you see the man on the front of the line. He is a jazz musician, his name's Al Hibbler. And this is where he was staying at the Gaston Motel. And the Gaston Motel was bombed. So when these people, these business people who hotels and restaurants and hotels, when they contributed to the civil rights movement, they were putting themselves and their businesses at risk because they could be bombed, they could be murdered. And there are many instances of violence, including the Lorraine Motel, where Martin Luther King was murdered, which is also in the Green Book. But how does the automobile become a tool, a weapon? This is the Jenkins microbus. If you think about how do you register voters? How did you register voters in the 60s? Well, you had to have a vehicle to drive around a county. You had to have a vehicle to bring healthcare, to bring education, to bring training and how to pass the poll tests to people. And they used this vehicle in particular was one that was used. It's now at the Smithsonian. So you had to have a car to do all those things. And of course, during the bus boycotts, this particular photograph is from the Montgomery bus boycott. Martin Luther King is ushering these women into a car. These women needed to get to work or they would lose their jobs. And the bus companies were counting on that, that they were the ones that took people to work. But Martin Luther King and the organizers of the boycott purchased a fleet of automobiles and they used those automobiles to drive people to work. And they bankrupted the bus company by 69%. So the major hotels, Howard Johnson's, Hilton, Ramada, the major chain hotels were boycotted regularly and sued by the NAACP. And this is, here you can see an NAACP boycott outside of, I believe it was a Hilton hotel. As a result, when the civil rights legislation was passed in 1964 and broke open those hotels, African Americans were able to stay at Hilton. They were able to stay at Howard Johnson's. And they did because they could and because they had worked so hard to break open segregation. What did that do? It killed a lot of Black businesses. So a lot of the network of businesses, the tourist homes, the guest houses, the rooms that women were renting in their homes to provide extra money for the family, it shut down all of those businesses. And they weren't really shut down because all African Americans stopped using them. They were shut down because no white Americans used them. So it didn't make up for the loss of revenue. And that's when places like Rock Rest closed because their revenue dropped precipitously. But we also have to think about traffic stops today. This is Philando Castile, who was murdered in his car by a policeman who thought he was reaching for a gun when he was reaching for his wallet and his driver's license. We have to think about the automobile as a place of danger for African Americans and a place that African Americans who go out on the road worry about every single time they go out on the road. And of course, George Floyd also was dragged out of his car to be murdered by a policeman. So I think every African American parent, and I am a parent of two grown children, one female, one male. Every African-American parent has the talk with their children. And that talk is about how you behave when a police officer comes up to the window of your car, because that police officer is maybe terrified of you because of the color of your skin. Not because you've done anything wrong, but because of the color of your skin. And it's really important for African-Americans to behave in a particular way to protect themselves. And that is where I will end, and I welcome your questions.
Thanks so much, Gretchen. That was tremendous. And I do remind our viewers to use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and type in your questions, and I can ask them of Gretchen. You know, one of the things that struck me as I was reading the book, from a preservation perspective, preservationists for the most part have a much different view of the automobile, right? So for us, the automobile has contributed to sprawl, to the loss of our, you know, walkable cities, the growth of strip mall America, everything to the detriment of our historic downtowns and our neighborhoods. But for African Americans, it's such a different story. You know, I wonder if you could say a little bit about the kind of the difference between those two viewpoints.
Yeah, I think it's a double-edged sword, because for African Americans, the automobiles provided freedom and decency, right? It takes you away from the very negative experience that African Americans had with public transportation. However, as highways were built, highways are often put through Black communities, and they have destroyed historically Black communities. So, you know, that is also a problem, that that Black communities have been disproportionately affected by urban renewal, or as we call it, Negro removal, and the building of the interstate highways. And African Americans loved highways in general, because you wanted to stay on the highway. You didn't want to drive through little tiny towns. If you were traveling, you had no idea what you would encounter if you were traveling through a little town. So it was preferable to stay on the highway and just pull off at a roadside rest area and eat your food that you've brought with you, or sleep if you needed to, and not have to go through a little town where you might have to deal with local sheriffs or local police officers or local mob. You just never knew. And there are instances of dangerous encounters that African Americans had by accidentally going through a little town. So, you know, it really is a double-edged sword. And I did find out a lot. A group asked me to speak called The War on Cars. And I was absolutely stunned when they told me how much they disliked car automobiles. And I said, well, that's not so true for the Black community.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned the Rapp Road Historic District here in Albany, a vernacular community site of for the Great Migration. And one of the big issues they're having now is their community is being used as basically a pass through.
Right.
And automobiles are kind of steaming down the road, and it's totally changed the complexion of that entire community for the worse. So I can see what you mean about the double-edged sword. You talked a little bit about the automobile as a really powerful tool for civil rights for African Americans. I wondered if you know, white car dealers had seen this and tried to resist selling automobiles to African Americans, or was there any kind of a movement where they saw this as a real threat to Jim Crow?
You know, money really talks in our culture, and African Americans were generally they could buy cars. Cadillac was the only dealership that really resisted selling their cars to African Americans. If you had the money, they would take your money. And if you couldn't buy a new car, you would buy a used car. So African Americans found ways of buying cars. You would either buy it from a dealership, you would buy it as a used car, or sometimes you could get a friend who was white to buy the car for you. So there were a whole variety of ways that African Americans found to to get a car. I love that somebody saw that that was a 55 Buick.
Yeah, somebody is sharp enough to see that.
I think that's great. I don't have that ability to date a car.
Right.
I really have to look at it.
Yeah, it seems that capitalism, at least in that way, played a positive role. And car dealerships weren't the only companies that were marketing themselves aggressively to the African American community, I would imagine.
Right, and then the first black automobile dealership, of course, is in Detroit. And once African American car dealers start to appear, African Americans have no problems buying cars. But it does take a little while, and it's not until the 50s that you start to see African-American car dealerships.
Yeah. You know, I wanted to, your book is also, I think, about the importance of place, which you've mentioned, something that preservationists know a lot about. What can you tell me about kind of the status of those vernacular places like Rock Rest that appear in the Green Book and other places? I know you and I had spoke yesterday, and you had mentioned some of the places here, Green Book sites in Albany. And one of the ones that kind of jumped to mind is the Kenmore Hotel on Pearl Street. And that's listed on the National Register, because of course, it's a big monolithic, building. But it is listed on the National Register. It's been transformed using historic tax credits into apartments. But there's other places like there's the garage on Lark Street, 137 Lark Street, which I think is now a cab company, a place where they use.
Oh, you found it.
I think so. Yeah. Somebody else online knows better. And you had also mentioned the Rhythm Club, the nightclub on Madison Avenue. So I did look around a little bit for that. And unfortunately, I did find an article in, at that time, the Knickerbocker News, great picture of the front of it, but it was lost to a fire in 1985. Yeah. So there had been a fire there, but you can still see even in that picture with the ladders up, what a great place that must have been. Have you seen any kind of a movement or any groups trying to identify and try to collect these sites and tell their stories?
Yes, a good friend of mine, Jennifer Root, who is an architectural historian, has a Green Book website. And Jennifer has been trying to document some of these places. Sadly, only about 5% of the sites in these guides are extant. And the reason is urban renewal and highways have been put through Black communities. And they've just not been considered important enough. So they've just gone by the boards. And Rock Rest is an interesting problem. It was about, I guess, almost 15 years ago now that one of the graduates of Cooperstown, a long ago graduate, called me, Richard Candy, who teaches at Boston University. And he teaches preservation, museum studies, I think. And he called me on a Wednesday night and said, there's this wonderful, wonderful tourist home. You have to see it. And he said, and they have a diary and manuscript materials. And literally he called me on a Wednesday. And I remember this because on Friday after work, we got in the car and drove to Maine to see this tourist home and spent the weekend there. And that's when I took the pictures and documented it. We contacted the Smithsonian and got all of the objects that are inside to the Smithsonian. So they're at the National Museum of African American History and Culture. And then the community started looking for what to do with this building. And ultimately, it has been sold into private hands. It's being restored. It looks great. They're taking care of it. I think part of the problem for all of these sites is that they've come late to the party. And so it's hard to find anybody who can take them on and give them a public purpose. Most of them are going to be privately owned, which is not a terrible thing, but it would be nice if some of them could be interpreted so that they had a broader a broader public story being told.
Yeah, and I think your point is a good one to mention again about the challenges of the National Register guidelines and the kind of difficulty in getting getting these cultural sites listed on the National Register. It's something I think that all preservationists are concerned about and talk about. I was curious about what you discovered about the role of African American women in writing your story, and if you might be able to elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, the very earliest travel guides, the very first one actually is put out during the Depression, and it's put out by the federal government, and it's just a listing of places, and almost all of the places are private homes. Mrs. George Smith's boarding house, Mrs. James Jones' boarding house. And these are women that have an extra room in their home or extra two rooms, and they're renting them out as a way of making money for the family. And they are providing you with a breakfast and maybe a dinner. And it's really the very first bed and breakfast. And I think that is so important. That's where W.E.B. Du Bois, when he was traveling, he often stayed with a family. And sometimes you could just stop in the town if you're traveling through, going through, and find the Black church and ask the pastor, and he would know who had an extra room. So this was a great way for women to make money. And I actually talked to an African-American hairdresser in Albany, and she was telling me about a place in Saratoga that was a boarding house, but also a brothel. Where you could be serviced and you could spend the night. And I thought, wow, that's a very interesting place. And yeah, she knew about it because the women, several of the women would come down and have their hair done.
Isn't that great? I mean, they have to be all over. Some of our comments kind of lead to that. One writer, not really a question, says Leslie, but I'm researching and documenting Black travel guide sites across Texas, mm-hmm. and she used your book as background research. So she wanted to thank you for
great.
That. That's great. Yeah. We also had a question, and I don't know, you'd probably have to thumb through your green book for this, but we had a question asking about African-American locations, facilities in the Rochester, New York area that have been ID'd and preserved. And I know you've probably got your green book handy. And I think in the chat, we even posted up something that can say where you can find copies, facsimile copies of the green book, so you can look and see for yourself.
Yes, Rochester has a couple of hotels on Charles Street, Industrial Street, Columbia Avenue, Clarissa Street. There's a restaurant called the Blue Lantern on Clarissa Street and Joseph Avenue, Dan's Tavern on Clarissa Street. So it looks like Clarissa Street was the Black community, if that still exists. And there were hotels and restaurants on that and tourist homes on that street. So sounds like that was the heart of the Black community.
Ryan had a question. He was wondering if there were specific garages or hidden and protected areas for parking that were established in addition to restaurants and lodging, a place where your cars basically could be safe and you didn't have to worry about them.
Not that I know of. The only place I have seen those segregated parking lots was in national parks. The maps of the national parks show, you know, a Negro lot and a white lot. I would assume that people parking on the street had to defer, that especially in the South, had to defer to white owners. And I do know of some Black people who are having their cars defaced or damaged because someone white didn't like them having such a nice car or such an expensive car. I don't know that their cars were necessarily safe when they went out on the road.
I don't know if you saw in the chat box, but Danielle said that in your book, she was fascinated to see how you describe the car as a multifunctional space, mobile architecture. Do you know of a list or visualization of the common car models? And of course, I know the answer to this because I saw it in your book, but you can answer the question.
In the 1940s and 50s, there were a series of market studies done in the United States in across the states in different cities, in Pittsburgh, in New York, in Baltimore, in Washington, D.C., in Seattle. And these market studies were designed basically to help to get advertising for newspapers. But they asked questions like, what kind of flour do you use? What kind of gasoline do you buy? What oil do you put in your car? And so they did surveys of Black communities in these cities, and they asked them about their automobiles, about their gasoline practices, and everything down to the salt they used on their tables. And that's where I discovered that Buick was the most popular car. And they actually went by percentages. So you could see that how much, what percentage of people said, I buy Fords. What percentage said, I buy Chrysler, I buy Hudson. And it was really obvious across the country that more people bought Buick than anything else. And only really for Cadillac, there was only 3% of the driving public, white or Black, bought Cadillacs.
And you said something interesting about that survey and the findings of that survey when we spoke earlier about the fact that African Americans would focus on high quality products because they were concerned about shoddy products being kind of pushed off onto them.
Right, and that's true not only of automobiles, but of, you know, they would drink Coca-Cola and Pepsi rather than store brands because they wanted to drink or buy the products that white Americans bought and that they knew would not have been dumped in Black neighborhoods because they were afraid of products being dumped on them.
Sure.
I'm starting to really understand why people are saying, well, I won't get the vaccine, because, you know, African Americans have been experimented on with the Tuskegee experiment. You know, of course, people are going to be a little bit skittish about something that is being, you know, kind of a mass vaccination program or a mass, you know, dumping of products in the Black neighborhood.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense given the history. Adrian had asked specifically about the Catskill Mountains, and she was wondering if the Catskill Mountains had any special interest for Black Americans, and did the Green Book list any places Black Americans were welcome to stay? She's especially interested in the Northern Catskills, but, you know, just in general.
So I actually did a program last year about the Catskills and did some research on the Catskills. Almost nothing is listed in the Green Book or in the other travel guides for the Catskills. And I think the reason is that it was so close to New York City that you'll find a ton of advertisements in the New York Amsterdam News for places in the Catskills. And the Catskills had little pockets, just like the city. I mean, there were, you know, there was a Black pocket, there was an Irish pocket. You know how you drive through Durham and everything is green and there are all these bars, and there was a pocket of Germans and a pocket of you know, various different groups throughout the Catskills. And there was a pocket of African Americans in the Catskills, including Peg Leg Bates had a resort in the Catskills. And if you actually go on YouTube, there is a short film of people dancing at Peg Leg Bates Resort, which is so fascinating. So yes, the African Americans went to the Catskills all the time. Most of the information about that can be found in the New York Amsterdam News and in Black newspapers. So some of that advertising you might find in the Baltimore Afro-American newspaper, because they were encouraging people from as far away as Baltimore to go to the Catskills. But you really don't find it in the travel guides.
Okay, interesting. And one last comment, I guess, question from Jeremy Wood. Do you know of any instances of dual waiting rooms, entrances to public facilities and so on that have been marked and interpreted to explain their history? You know, where they maybe kept those signs?
You know, I don't. I would assume that they do it in the Greyhound bus station that is there is a Greyhound bus station that is on the National Register and that is a museum now. But I don't know of any other places that actually, most places have gotten rid of their dual entrance. And I see that Ryan Donaldson, I wonder if it's my Ryan Donaldson, my former student, but I see that Ryan Donaldson in the chat talks about the hidden in plain sight, ghosts of segregation. And that article does show a variety of buildings that have a segregation entrance. You just have to know where to look at this architecture, and you can see what used to be an entrance or what used to be a separate area where people congregated on this architecture, so that the evidence is still there. You just have to know where to look.
And I think we just sent the link to that article in the chat. Well, I can't believe it, but our hour is up. I want to thank Gretchen Sorin for spending the last hour with us to discuss her book, Driving While Black, African-American Travel and the Road to Civil Rights. I hope you all consider attending one or more of our upcoming book clubs. On Thursday, February the 11th, we'll be discussing The Architecture of Troy by author and League trustee Diana Waite. On Thursday, March the 4th, we'll be discussing It's a Hell of a Town, Joan K. Davidson and the J.M. Kaplan Fund and the Fight for a Better New York by author and League trustee Roberta Gratz. And on Thursday, March 11th, when we will be discussing The Warmth of Other Suns, the epic story of America's Great Migration by Isabel Wilkerson. And if you've not, if you're not currently a supporter of the Preservation League of New York State, I encourage you to visit our website at www.preservenys.org and join us so we can do more wonderful programs as you've enjoyed tonight. So Gretchen, thank you again for taking the time with us. It's just a wonderful story and a magnificent book, and I'm glad that it's getting the attention that it deserves. And I encourage everyone to go out and buy a copy. It's a really great read, and as it goes without saying, it's a part of our history, I think, that's so important to tell and told from a very interesting perspective. So thank you, Gretchen. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Good night, everyone.